Arthur will become father probably today, so he has something else to do than coming to IKEA, but it's will be also a great event for him. So the vision of our work is very similar to Markov logic networks. It's putting a probabilistic model on a relational database. Today, there is a lot of data. So here I took one example of a huge knowledge base, which is actually distributed across many, many research centers on biological data. So you have many tables, basically. The most important one are the genes, where it's a big matrix, where each row is an individual, or maybe the genome. Each row is an individual, each column is a gene expression, or specific gene expression. And all these data are connected to each other through some semantic web type of technology or distributed knowledge base. And you might want to ask questions such as, is there a link between gene A and disease B? What is the impact on the environment on the gene expression? What we would like to do is to answer such type of question, but having a unique model, not having one specialized classification task. We'd like to have a global model to be able to answer to local questions. So in this talk, I won't speak about Markov logic network or tensor factorization, which are two state-of-the-art methods for this type of data, but I will concentrate on a third type of approach called collective matrix factorization. So I don't know if many of you are familiar with collective matrix factorization. It's a very powerful approach, and I will give you a short introduction to it. Speak about the improvements that we have done on it, called root sparse embedding, and show you several numerical experiments. So collective matrix factorization starts with a simple matrix. So when you have a simple matrix, this is a relation, it's a single view. You have two entity types, well, the row entity types and the column entity types. You can represent this schema using this small graphical model here. In multi-view learning, you have several matrices concatenated together, or equivalently, you have m plus 1. So if you have m views, you have m plus 1 entity types. So one entity type, T1, is connected somehow with plenty of features, for example. So typically, when you have a multi-label classification, T1 represents an item, a document to classify, T2 represents a feature set, and T3 the set of labels in a multi-label classification task. So this matrix might be continuous, this matrix might be binary. So it's important to consider them as a concatenation of matrix rather than a full global matrix with the same entity, the same values inside. But what's original with collective matrix factorization, as you will see in the next slide, is that you can concatenate matrix in a somewhat strange way. So for example, if you want the T3, if you have a connection between T3 and T2, two entity types, you will have to concatenate the matrix together, but you cannot, actually, you would need a 3D representation to concatenate the type 1 to type 2, the type, type 1 to type 2, type 2 to type 3, and type 3 to type 1. This type of circular relationship cannot be handled by simple concatenation of matrices. And here, a typical example of this augmented multi-view setting is when you have, say, a website connected to items that are sold to users, and users are connected to websites. And in general, you can have any type of relational database with arbitrary schema. So what we'll do is just put a factorial model on top of it. So it's exactly what is PCA, even the single view here, or what can be related to CCA, canonical correspondence analysis, or multi-view learning, when you concatenate multiple matrices. In this more general setup, in augmented multi-view and relational database, this can be called collective matrix factorization instead of multi-view learning. It's basically an extension of multi-view learning. Mathematically, the model is pretty simple. So you express the value of matrix M for the entity I as a row and the TTJ as a column as a Lorentz representation, like having a Lorentz matrix for each of the views. And then you can see that you have to select the embedding, so the latent representation of each matrix, using this RM and CM variable, which represent the schema of your database. So basically here, to express the MF view, you will need to have the entity type RM for the row and the entity type CM for the column. What's very important in collective matrix factorization is to use the Bayes term. I don't know if some of you used collaborative filtering application without the Bayes term. It's really important to take this into account. And we can consider arbitrary noise, not only the noise, the Gaussian noise, you can use heavy tape noise, or logistic observation for binary data. So this is the standard model. You can learn it using math inference. It's great, it works, but maybe we can improve it if we want to go large scale. So there is a simple interpretation for this model in terms of the decomposition of a symmetric matrix. I'd like to introduce it very shortly, very quickly. So here you have this example of a circular schema. You can start with an empty matrix, which is rectangular, which contains all the entity of all the types, and you can represent it as putting x1 in this slot, the transpose of x1 in this slot, and you do it again with x2 and with x3. So now you end up with a symmetric matrix with some missing data, but this, you can factorize it very efficiently, and actually it leads to some reweighted eigenvalue solver, so you can solve this system efficiently. So you can represent it as a Lorentz representation, and collective matrix factorization can be represented as simply factorizing this matrix. So for more general schema, you can also build such a matrix and have a Lorentz representation. So basically, each of these matrix here would be of the rank of the global embedding. So here, I represented embedding of size 6 for each of my entry. And each of the matrix, x1, x2, x3, and x4, have rank 6. But this is not really something that you would like, especially for people familiar with CCA. You have view-specific variations that you would like to take into account. And this is an issue. You do not want to have a rank 6 matrix for each of these views. Some views might be simpler than others. It depends on the type of the data. So this is where group sparse embedding come into play. What we'll assume is exactly the same model, but instead of having Gaussian prior for the embedding, we'll try to group the embedding by type. So for all entities of the same type, we'll try to group them together to be zero together if it's possible. So in a Bayesian framework, so we choose a Bayesian framework, we could do structure sparsity, like group sparse L1, L2 penalty. Here we choose the Bayesian framework because it's just simpler to understand. So you put a prior which is normal with mean zero, and the precision for each of the elements of the group. So here you see that this is for the entity E of the type E. You have a variance which is depending only on the entity type. And it's specialized for each of the factors. Alpha, the precision value of the embedding, follows the gamma prior with very uninformative prior, and this enables automatic relevance determination. So it's quite an old concept in Bayesian methodology. So when you do variational bias and you learn such a model, some alpha tends to infinity. And you can remove them. This corresponds an alpha which tends to infinity means a zero variance. So basically, your embedding equals zero. So during the learning of your embedding, you will have exact zeros. And this is the type of factorization that you can obtain on the previous example. Here, instead of having my full dense embedding, you can represent each of the matrix as being low rank. For example, X1 has rank 2. It is composed only of the value of the embedding in the factor 1 and 2, in the dimension 1 and 2. You can see that the matrix X4 is only rank 1. It is expressed only as a multiplication of the unique factor, which is it. So this is what we have done, and we have made a lot of experiments to try to illustrate the benefit of having this higher information. Not only it helps in regularization, I would like to say that it's also very useful to compress data. So even if you had other ways to do it, the fact that it's sparse, the fact that you have exact zeros, enables you to store very large models in a very compact way. The algorithm, I will go very quickly on top of it, but if you have met a Bayesian guy, he's not using SGD. We use alternating optimization, which is nearly closed form. Only the first part, the mean updates, we did a small trick to accelerate the inversion of the K by K matrix. But otherwise, it's very similar to a MAP type of inference. You only have, in addition, some variance estimation. What's important in what we have done is that we properly treated the case of non-Gaussian data, meaning binary and on Poisson data. Let's look at some experiments. So as I mentioned, this application in biology, you can have gene expression and copy number change. Here you have two views, but there is a prior assumption that the genes which are close in the view 1, so the columns in X1, you have the same number of columns in X2, and you have a proximity, a chromosomal proximity between the views. So here we have in X3 a binary bound diagonal noisy matrix which represents the proximity between the genes. The question is X3 useful? If we did not have X3, this would be a classical multi-view setting. So this is what we'll compare. We'll compare to the CMF, so no group sparsity, CCA, no chromosomal proximity, and PCA, it's independent views. By varying the number of missing data in our framework, so in the horizontal line, this is the performance of the algorithm, of our algorithm, and here you have the relative RMS. So it means that if you have a method which is above the black line, it's worse than the proposed method, and if it's below, it's better. So we see that here, for a large range of missing value, basically from 0 to 70%, having a group sparse prior is better than CMF. CMF is in red. And what's strange in this data is also that CMF and CCA are relatively similar. So the fact that you are able to take into account this additional view comes really with the fact that we have taken the group sparsity into account. Another nice example is in this simple data set of, it's called Yale data set of faces. So you have pairs of images, so here you have faces which have two lighting conditions, left light and right light. We observe 8 persons with these two views and 7 persons with only one view, and we try to guess the pixels of the missing view. With this experiment, we can define X3 as being the pixel proximity. Because since we have very few images, we only have 8 persons, knowing that some pixels are close to each other will help in regularizing, because this information cannot be learned only with 8 images. And this is what we see in the results here, is that depending on the neighborhood width, so basically, this is the width of the band of X3. You have an optimal so-called neighborhood width of 10 pixels, which tells you that indeed the proximity, the spatial proximity of pixels, if you take this into account in this data set, helps in generalizing, in predicting the missing value. And then we did two simulations, one to show that binary data is actually very useful. So the baseline is CMF with Gaussian. And then we do the group sparse CMF with Gaussian. But since the data were generated according to this schema with binary matrix, we can see that if we take into account the Bernoulli loss that we define, we get a better result. And if we, in addition, take the group sparsity, we have even better performances. And also, we did a simulation between VB and MAP, because often people say, why don't you do MAP? It's so similar to MAP, to do VB. The key point here is that there is no tuning parameter. We not only we have better predictive performances, but we don't have tuning parameter. Everything is learned, estimated, by maximizing the expected lower bound of variational bias. So this is really something which is great. So I will skip the last experiment of the model system and speak about the take-home message. So CNF is a flexible and generic model for relational data. Multi-view, augmented multi-view is very common. A lot of data have this setup. And Bayesian learning, it really works. There is no tuning parameter. Even in the algorithm, we did alternating least square, there is no gradient step. We did not tune anything. Or maybe we chose the rank, which was sufficiently big so that it can be discarded. If we had chosen to initialize our data with rank 2, it wouldn't have worked. But if you initialize your data with a sufficiently big rank, there is no tuning parameter. And it's quite strange. I'm quite upset that it's working. But Bayesian methodology seems, in this setting, to be able to tune a lot of parameters, which otherwise would be a nightmare with gradient-free optimization and things like that, and multiple initialization. And you have seen the benefit of group sparsity. And the ongoing work is on putting predictive queries, so redefining SQL and SparkQL to query not only the data, but also the model. Approximate reasoning, similar to what we have, what was mentioned by Pedro. Convex and Bayesian, I'm working on a convex formulation of variational bias. It's by using the upper bound rather than the lower bound of the evidence. Missing links in RDF, there is still an open question whether you should treat missing information as missing or as zeros. And a very exciting project is about privacy preserving learning of the embeddings. So the idea is that everybody keeps its own private data but shares the embedding. And this is might be a good solution for the privacy preserving machine learning. If you're interested, there is a code which is available on CRAN. It's an R package and it's simply ready to work with your own data.
So what if some of the objects have attributes, their composition of images? Is there anyone to handle this in that framework?
So you can put the attributes in a matrix. Are you asking about the fact that you can have...
So let's say one of the objects is an image. So it's, you want to have a separate matrix for each pixel. You want to learn an embedding that's a function of the pixels.
Yes, this is. So this is what we did here. We had an item feature. So we transformed the image into a feature representation.
Right.
And then this creates a matrix, X5, who is just appended, concatenated, as one of the matrix was that we factorized jointly with the others. So if this the information coming from the image could be pixels, by the way. Helps, then it will help in
the so you put them directly in the embedding structure.
Yeah, so basically here, in this case, basically an embedding as the data. But obviously, we'd like to have maybe a deep architecture where we jointly learn with it.
Yes. So if I understood correctly, you create this large matrix that has every one of the relation matrices as a submatrix. But then it also has a lot of submatrices that basically correspond to relations that don't exist, right? And what happens with those? Do you hallucinate the relations that don't exist, or
it's does a very that good never question. Happen? So this is a big question. Should I replace the missing data, the question mark in this, by zeros? It would force embeddings to be orthogonal, because the zeta dot product would be zero. Which, and I'd like to do this experiment, trying both on different data sets to see what the impact of indeed having this somehow orthogonality constraint of the embedding. I simply don't have the intuition about what would be the results, but yeah, I'm interested in these questions.
Well, let's thank Guillaume and have a break. Back in 20 minutes.